Going to call the meeting to order at 6:30. Due notice having been posted for the Somerset School Committee for Thursday, April 14th, 2016. Let the record show this meeting is being electronically recorded. If anyone in the audience wishes to electronically record, they should let us know at this time. All right, by roll call, Mrs. Tara.
Here.
Mr. Machado.
Here.
Mr. Botello.
Here.
Mrs. Rothwell.
Here.
The chair is present as well. We also have Mr. Schoonover, our superintendent of schools, Mrs. Albernez, our director of business and finance, Ms. Haskell, the director of curriculum, and Mr. Levesque, our technology director, present with us at the meeting. Our first order of business will be the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Our next scheduled meeting for the Somerset School Committee is scheduled for Thursday, May 19th at 6:30 in the school committee room. However, just we'll be having some conversation regarding that on the agenda under new business. So tentatively it is set for the 19th and possibly later it'll be changed. I will entertain a motion to consider the acceptance of the open session minutes from March 22nd, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That is unanimous. And since I was not present at the joint meeting, if somebody else would like to make that motion.
I'll consider a motion for the acceptance of open session minutes from March 22nd, 2016.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
I'm abstaining.
And one abstention.
I think we have the joint executive session minutes as well.
I'll consider a motion to accept the joint open session minutes from March 24th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And one abstention.
Thank you, Mrs. Rothwell. Mm-hmm. First, under communication, we have Mr. Plant, our principal here from Chase Street. And he is going to do a Chase Street School student presentation. So I am going to turn the floor over to Mr. Plant and let him make his presentation.
All right. Good evening, everybody. Nice to be here. As you see in back of you is Chase Street School fifth grade snow globe. So they decorated the school committee room. So I'd like to acknowledge, I thank Mrs. Well, around here it's Monis. Towards where I am, it's Manise, for you know, putting up the bulletin board. So I thank her personally. All right, what I'm going to present tonight is the Chase Street School PBIS video. Coming into the school district last year with all the schools being moved around, new students coming in, we needed some kind of common language. So this way, when kids came from other areas, different schools, they knew what the expectations were. So we felt that that was very important. So we got a group together of teachers, parents, and so forth, and we put together what we call our PBIS team, Positive Behavior Intervention Supports. Everything that we do, we try to force positive, positive, positive. So we ended up coming up with a bunch of common language, how to walk down the hallways, how to sit in the cafeteria, how to get on and off the bus, and so forth. And all the students now, we put it in place probably about March last year, so they got a little taste of it this year. We really started it this year. So now all the teachers, whether it be custodians, cafeteria, bus, they all know that certain things we do at Chase Street School. And the video will kind of show what we do. So we were able to grab a few, I was able to call the high school, Mr. Califf, who is the video person there. Asked him, I told him what I'd like to do. He came by with two young men, and they came and they videotaped it. So it was nice, so I thank the high school for, you know, helping out. Again, we want to have that, you know, connection with them. So what we did is we put a video together from Chase. Certain classes were picked to do it. Most of the classes might have been the PBIS members, because it was easy, because they were there to volunteer their classes and so forth. So it's about 10 minutes. So I'm going to play the video for you, and then if you have any questions, obviously, you know, ask them away. I know if you have children at Chase, we do a lot of what we call a dolphin diner. Okay, so students are caught being good. They get little, what we call dolphin tails, and the teacher will write the student's name and check off whether they were responsible, respectful, or safe. And usually once every other week, I'll pull the names out of each grade level hat. And then they get to pick a friend to sit on the stage with their grade level. They love this. It's, you know, they're always walking down the hall. They look at me, this means zero, you know, nice and quiet. And they walk by me and they expect me to give a dolphin tail. I say, guys, you can't do it that way. You got to earn it. Just because you see me, you can't walk by and, you know, do that. So, but we have a lot of fun with it. The kids love it. I noticed the fourth and fifth grade, as we've been going through now, they're like, oh, okay, you know, we get to sit, big deal. So I think, you know, our next meeting with the PBIS, we have to come up with a little more catch for the fourth and fifth graders. But the younger ones absolutely love it. So that's where we are with that. We also up the ante. Now that they get their names picked out, they also get what we call our little dolphin chase keychain, which I have one for all of you here. Because now you're going to be inducted into the Dolphin Hall of Fame, I guess. Only students that are picked out of the little basket get one of these. So it's a special thing. So kids, you know, they hook them on their belt, their book bags, they have a good time. So, all right, so I'm going to play the video for you. I might shut the lights, might be easy to see. It's about 9 minutes long. Comes in with the parents there, we'll kind of show them the video and just say, you know, this is kind of things that we do at Chase Street School. So they have an idea of how it is. They just don't walk in and they don't know what's expected of them. Well, but you get the idea.
Try not.
Yeah.
Stay seated at all times.
That's the logo that the high school, we had the art teacher bring some kids and they painted that in the gym. They're going to do it on the sidewalk.
Here at Tasting School, our dolphins are
Responsible!
Now you're an honorary.
Thank you.
Enjoy this.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I ran out, guys, sorry. Any questions?
Well, I'd just like to say, it's good to see, I know there was a lot of changes the last few years with kids coming from different schools and trying to figure out a way to integrate them. And it's good to see you trying to put some ground rules down on, you know, getting everybody back and on the same page. So I know it's probably the first year was probably quite an adjustment, but it looks like, you know.
No, it's running a lot smoother now.
We appreciate it. I don't know if there's any questions or comments from the committee.
Well, I just have a comment, because, again, I've probably said this before, but I have to say it again. I just love Chase Street School. We were there for 11 years. I had three kids that were there, and it's such a great school. I think you're doing a great job.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate hearing that.
I miss Chase Street, so I'm sitting there. I remember all the memories of my little ones and some of the teachers my kids had, and they're still there. There's just a lot of good memories there. It's a great school. So.
I can enjoy the kitchen.
All our schools are great, but Chase is special to me, so thank you.
Yeah, I think, you know, all those kids, obviously, they did pretty well, which is great. I'm sure they had fun doing that, too.
Yeah, they had a lot of fun. Everybody wanted to be part of the video. You know, and then it was like, oh, we can only whittle it down to so many guys, and we only have so much time in the day. And, you know, but it was fun. And like I said, we'll use it in September to show the kindergarten kids, you know, this is what we do at Chase. How you play, you know, and well, the parents will be able to see that too. So
great.
Then hopefully we can do some upbeat music and a few other things.
So. Yeah. So that's actually a good idea. Do other schools do any kind of, like, what you're talking about, like videos for?
As far as I know,
the process or procedures.
I've only done it here. I know I've spoken to Dr. Pereira. She's interested. Lane's interested. They want. I was kind of like the guinea pig to see working with the high school. You know, I like to reach out to the high schools. I think that's important.
Sure.
That's why I reached out to the art to get them to do the dolphin in, you know, the gym. We are going to put one in the sidewalk to wait for the weather, obviously.
Yeah.
And then we put one in the cap, you know, so it has a nice ownership. The PTO now has taken that image, and now we're going to do t-shirts with that for spirit wear. So we changed all the old dolphin. This will be the new dolphin look. So we'll keep it going. And, you know, I'm having a good time there. We just got now parks coming up different things, so that'll be interesting, but it is what it is.
So you think with the redistricting, everybody's settled, should, or a year and a half, we're all good now, right?
I think that there's still, I think, some people that still feel close to other schools and stuff, but I think it's getting a lot better. Last year, I could feel a lot of, you know, anxiety and tensions and stuff. I think this year, it's gotten a lot better. You know, they know me, I know them now. I think they're kind of at ease now, and they figure, okay, we made the change, now it's time to get to work and go through with it. I mean, kids are resilient, they move on.
Yeah, I'd say, just as Mrs. Tara just said, you know, after you send your kids to a certain place for a number of years, you know, it grows on you, you become part of it, it becomes part of you, and when it's not there, it still is an adjustment. I think people have accepted it, but, you know, I think there are still some feelings for the other place with some families, which is to be expected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I also think, you know, Mr. Plan, thank you for bringing this to us, but also I think having you there and bringing stability back into that leadership role there, it's been very important to the parents. And I know the kids like you because I always joke around with my daughter and she's constantly saying stuff, you know, that she likes you. And but I also thought it was kind of a what I really enjoyed about it is your little camo appearance in that video. Like, oh, the camera's on me.
Yeah, it's the kids' video.
But it's nice.
But I lost 28 pounds since that video. So now I'll go in the video, no problem. But no, I really enjoy it there. You know, getting to know the staff now I think is great. You know, getting over that hump of somebody new, maybe someone coming in and then leaving in a year. Now they know, hey, I'm there. You know, I'm going to be there as long as I can be there. I have a good time with the staff, good time with the kids, the families. You know, I really enjoy it, so. I'll be there for you.
Good. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Thank you, Mr. No. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.
Next on the agenda under communication, superintendent's update. Okay. Mr. Schoonover.
Thank you. Just a few updates. First, actually, we'll jump right in from something that's happening at Chase. Tomorrow is the American Cancer Society Paint Your World Purple Day. So we do have a few teams from the school district. One from Chase for a Cure, one from North called Hula for Hope. They participate every year, Bishop Conley, in the Relay for Life for the American Cancer Society. So tomorrow in all of the schools, so the captains of those two teams from Chase and North, they've organized throughout both school districts for teachers, for kids, to wear purple tomorrow. And when you leave the building, you'll see some footprints on the window for central office. So we've been collecting donations, and it's all gonna go to, the proceeds will go to these two teams, which will then go to the American Cancer Society. Kids are selling these purple bracelets. And I'm trying to think of, who are the captains for the Chase team?
Mrs. Hargraves and Mrs. Ryan.
Okay. And Mrs. Ray Ray is the captain of the team here at North. And you know, we've had faculty members who have battled through cancer while they've been teaching. We have some who are, you know, they're going through this now. And so this is a nice community event. One of our goals in our strategic plan is that promoting that dedication to the community and our kids, and these events happen quite frequently. So tomorrow it's across the board, all 2,800 students or so, and all of our faculty members, many of them will be wearing purple. We also have with community Envisioning Somerset. I'm not sure if this is something, I know Mrs. Rothwell and Mrs. Terra have heard about this from the Somerset Berkeley side, but Mrs. Troutman, an art teacher, my photography teacher at the high school, applied for this grant won it. And we're going to have, I think it's about 10 or 12 banners, large photo banners, 10 by 10, placed on various town buildings. A few in Berkeley, I think 8 to 10 in Somerset. Those are going to be going up in the next few weeks. So you're going to see some at the high school, Pottersville, the Historical Society, the Town Library, two at South, two at North. And there might be another building or two in there. I think Bakehouse Bank is also gonna be holding one. So you're gonna see these large photo banners. So these are all photos taken by students at Somerset Berkeley Regional High School in the digital photography program. The pictures are just outstanding. So the next time we have a meeting here at North, you will see on Whetstone Hill facing the road, two of these large banners. I believe it'll be to the right of where the maintenance garage is. But you'll see those around town on various buildings. You probably also noticed here the solar project work that started this week. It's expected to be wrapped up by the end of May, and it'll go live, I guess, sometime around the beginning of the summer. Okay, so I know Lindsay will be giving all of us updates as that work progresses. And last night, we had the State of Somerset address. This is something that the Board of Selectmen asked that the various departments in town participate in. So the school department was there, water and sewer, and Mr. Brown gave a presentation on the municipal side. We spoke about the school department. Mr. Pierce started about Somerset Berkeley, and I went in and gave a presentation about both school districts. I thought it was a very good event. You know, there was a short time for questions and answers at the end, but the information that we're able to relay, just the focus was, what have we done in the past? You know, what's happening now, and what's the plan for the future, just so we can see where we're heading. So we talked about finances, but also our curriculum instructional initiatives that we have going on. One of them, Liz will be talking about a little bit later on this evening. But it was a great event. So we were sharing that information with the town, Mr. Patello was there. I don't know if he has anything to add, but I thought it was very well received.
I think it was good. You know, each of the town groups were able to give their presentation. Of course, you know, these fine gentlemen were there as well. I think between what Mr. Pierce said and what Mr. Schoonover said, I think they covered pretty well, you know, where their schools were several years ago and where we are now and where we're transitioning to. Obviously, the town side had some pretty good information as well. And I think there are more questions about water and sewer than there were about schools. So that's usually good to see the heat, you know, taken off us and put on to someone else. But I think it was a pretty good event. I'd like to see something like that expanded. One of the things that the town administrator did make mention of is taking use of all the resources in the town and sharing that among the different communities. Like, one of the things is technology, right? And I'd love to see more of that, right? So not only technology, but electricians, plumbers, whatever we have in the town, if we can share services, you know, between the town departments, I think that's, you know, beneficial for everybody. So hopefully that's just the beginning of what's to come as far as, you know, more collaboration between the schools and the town side. But
yeah, I agree, it was nice to hear that. And that's something I believe we've talked about. I'm not sure if it was in budget subcommittees, but we've talked about that sharing of resources and how, you know, we might be able to offer the town one thing and maybe the highway department can pick something up for the school department, and, you know, just sharing of those resources that we have, so we're not all outsourcing or bringing these private vendors in to do some work when we have the talent right here, either in the school department, municipal side, or you know, highway department or whatever. So I agree, that was a nice message to hear from them.
Yeah, just be interested to see what the next steps are.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay.
One thing too, Mr. Schoonover, that you didn't bring up is you did have a park presentation that you and Haskell did as well. So.
It was thank you. That was on Monday evening. It seems like it was forever ago already. we had a presentation at the high school and the distance learning center. We had about 20 or so people show up, but we gave a presentation just showing some sample questions that students will be asked to do. And regardless of, you know, if it's park, just the types of questions that our students should be answering based on the Massachusetts standards. So I thought it was a nice turnout. There were some great questions that the parents there were asking. Liz, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I thought that it was a really nice opportunity to talk a little bit about, you know, what we expect from our kids, and as important as the park testing is, one of the things, from a parent's perspective, and I also am a parent of a child who is going to be taking park right after vacation, you know, talking to our kids about the fact that it's important and we need to do our best, but this is not going to make or break our career as we're looking at this exam, and that we want to go to bed early and hydrate and you know, really have some positive self-talk in terms of I can do this, and really encouraging the perseverance of kids, you know, hanging in there, because it is going to be a long day and there's a lot of thinking that they're going to be doing, but being able to take a moment and take some deep breaths and then get back to it. Our principals are working really hard to make sure that our teachers and our kids are going in with confidence. And that was some of what we talked about also, not just those skills. They've prepared for this all year, and they're gonna be ready to go, and just reinforcing that, I think, is a really important piece, you know, from the home side, so.
Well, what I thought, because I was there, what both of you did was not only that, but explained the history of why we made the decision and what might be coming down the pipe, per se. And also that whole thing of, yes, we are preparing our children, and what we're doing in the classroom will relate to the test, and it shouldn't be anything out of the ordinary for our kids. So thank you for that.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Schoonover. We do have some new business for tonight's meeting. The first one is going to be a town meeting presentation. We obviously have a town meeting coming up where we're going to have to present some articles. I don't know, Lindsay, do we know how many articles are finalized for the school side? We have quite a few that are like...
Excluding the capital, there are, I believe, six.
Six?
I mean, I'm sorry, excluding the revolving fund, there's six.
Right, and then the revolving funds are mostly zero and just continuing them on, right? Okay, so are we looking to figure out who's going to make the, present the warrants? Because I have no problem doing that unless somebody else is, you know, really excited about standing up in front of town meeting. Otherwise, I can, obviously...
I don't mind either way. I think last year, did we split it last year? Where was it last year?
I think...
You split it last year. You did the operating budget.
I did the operating budget, which is fine. I don't have an issue doing that.
Yeah, I don't care either way. If it's easier for one person to do it, fine. If you want to split them up, I'll take some.
All right, does anybody have any problem if we just, myself or the superintendent, figure out who's going to do the articles? Okay, so I'll take the operating budget and I'll talk to Mr. Patel about maybe doing some of the revolving funds or whatever. We'll split them in half and figure out what's going to be easy so we're not getting up and down and continuously going back up and down.
So this is probably a sad question, but what date is the town meeting?
It's May 16th.
It's going to be May 16th?
That's kind of what I thought, but I didn't see it in my calendar. I'm like, okay.
All right.
Thank you.
And if anybody in particular wants to present one, just let myself or Mr. Schoonover know, and then we can figure that out. All right?
Okay.
And I believe you guys will do somebody. Mrs. Albernazimus will do a quick, maybe, presentation for the people in the audience on kind of where we are and what's happening. And
very quick.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
We both feel that simpler is better.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Appreciate it. All right, next, under new business, we have a 2016-2017 school calendar.
Okay, you have a copy of that calendar in your packet. There are on the K-8 side, and what I sent you a copy of a calendar several weeks ago. What I've done here, not to confuse matters, this is just Somerset Public Schools. This does not have any of the Somerset Berkeley, or should not have any of the Somerset Berkeley dates or references on here. So the first day of school for students is Tuesday, September 6th. By contract, our teachers begin the Wednesday before Labor Day. So you'll see in red, Wednesday, August 31st, and Thursday, September 1st are the two professional days for teachers. All of our students in grades 1 through 8 start on Tuesday the 6th, and then our preschoolers and kindergartners start the following Monday. During that first week of school, there is a kindergarten orientation that takes place. There are some additional kindergarten screenings for new students who enrolled over the summer. So our kindergarten teachers are busy doing some other things that week. So K students start on that Monday the 12th. Right away that first week, that first full week of school, we have on the 14th and 15th our back to school nights, 14th for elementary, 15th for the middle school. And per the contract, when teachers, as you know, when we have an evening activity like back to school night, parent teacher conferences, there is an early release day on that Friday, so that's why the 16th is coded purple. We have included a few more early release days for professional development in this calendar, the first being on September 30th. There are six such days built in for next school year. We had three this year. It's just, we don't have a lot of professional development time for teachers. This time is crucial, whether it's bringing in someone to provide an outside person to provide training, or whether it's time for teachers to, you know, that much-needed time for teachers to work together in a team, grade-level team, department team, you know, reviewing student work, working on curriculum, whatever the case may be, that those six early release days will be utilized in different ways. Excuse me, in October, this is now a change. When I, you know, I don't have the results with me, but this past fall, and I think it was Mr. Patello who asked about the parent-teacher conferences at the middle school. The way it had been organized before is on a Thursday afternoon, we had an early release day for students. Then we had on that Thursday afternoon, parent-teacher conferences. There was a short break, and then we had more conferences that same evening. And then an early release day on the Friday. So students had those two early release days in a row. I surveyed, sent a survey out, you probably all received it, and it was overwhelming that parents preferred evening conferences. They did not want to have the, while some still said they prefer an afternoon, it was, I think it was about 80% who said, we'd like to have the two conferences, we'd like to have a model, you know, more similar to the high school. So we had that change, and also by the contract, when this happens, we meet with the members of the STA, so President Sheehan and I, and then we have a teacher from each level, elementary, middle, high, and we have an elementary principal, middle school principal, and high school principal. So the eight of us got together and we reviewed the structure of parent-teacher conferences and so on, and we went over this about maybe a month or so ago. For that, because our middle school conferences were happening on back-to-back nights, that Friday the 28th is a no school day for our middle school students. So instead of getting two early release days, they have a day off, faculty and students. In November is the typical, we have really the only major change from this year is we do have the professional day back on election day, November 8th. December, we're following the same model at the elementary level as with the middle, with the elementary schools, I'm sorry, the middle school. So on December 14th and 15th, we have two consecutive evenings of parent-teacher conferences. The elementary parents answered the questions the same way as our middle school parents. They overwhelmingly preferred evening conferences. And if you recall, I think that was the most challenging for families to attend. It was during the school day. And I know that there are many parents who forced to take a day out of work in order to, or time out of work to go attend one of those conferences. Like with the middle school on Friday, December 16th, that's a no school day for students and teachers. We come back to school on January 3rd, and then on January 13th, we see our second early release day for PD, and then we'll see a few consecutive months, February 10th, March 17th, and then on the town election day, May 8th, and then you'll see four purple days in June, so the three that we already have, plus a fourth day so that we can begin doing some curriculum work and prep work for the 17-18 school year. The 184th day for faculty members, the 181st day for students, is Monday, June 19th. I will say that because elementary and middle school have those two Fridays off, or you know, each level has a Friday off because of the conferences, our high school teachers get out their last day, and students is on Friday, June 16th. So with that extra day off built in, our K-8 teachers have to return on that Monday, assuming no snow days. And you see the 5 days that are built into the calendar that we are required to have in there by the Department of Ed for snow days. That doesn't mean if we have 8 snow days, we will still make up 8 snow days, and the last day of school would be, you know, the 28th, 29th, whatever. So I don't know why we're still forced to have those days, but, you know, that's a state requirement for us. Questions?
Yes, I do. So under early release days, because yes. I was getting a little kind of confused where you said there was days off from the parent teachers conference. So I was looking like, where's just day off? So is there a way of putting...
Oh, you know what? That should actually, I should move those two out of early release and put them up under something else.
Right, or put early release days in or no school days.
Yes, I will modify that.
Because then I'm looking like vacation days, school vacations. It's not a vacation day or a school vacation.
You're absolutely right. That was an oversight. Thank you.
So if you could fix that, it'd be great.
I will.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other question? Is this the first reading or is this, would you like us to vote on it?
If you, really, it doesn't, I don't think it matters to me. I think the high school, have you normally done two readings in the past, Mr. Machado?
We have, but I've always, my question is always, I'm assuming that the STA also have seen the calendar. That's my only concern. So if everybody, so I support whatever.
Yeah, I don't see it necessary for a second read.
Okay, so, and you're going to then move October 28th.
And December 16th. They'll label that differently or call it, or I'll move it in under, I'll figure out how to code that differently.
Okay.
Okay.
And those are the 2 days where we're making adjustments for parent-teacher conferences. Okay. So I will entertain a motion to adopt the Somerset Public Schools 2016-2017 school calendar as presented by Mr. Schoonover, with the two exceptions that have been discussed on October 28th and December 16th, where there are no school days, to have them moved to their own subject line.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Thank you. That is unanimous. Thanks, Mr. Schoonover.
Thank you.
Okay. I know earlier I mentioned under new business the possible changing date of the May 19th meeting. I know that one of our members will be out of town. So I believe we're looking at either the 17th, 18th, 16th, 17th, or 18th. Is that correct, Mr. Machado?
You are
16, 17,
18?
You are still 16.
No.
16th, 17th.
Yeah, right. 16th is obviously the
town meeting.
So I don't know if the 17th or 18th works. For anybody, I can make either one. I don't have anything going on those days. If you want to check your calendars.
I might be traveling on the 18th. So.
Okay, so how does the 17th look for Mrs. Tara and Mrs. Rothwell? The 17th is good for you, Mr. Machado?
I am not available on the 17th. I would be available on the 16th.
Okay, the 16th is a town meeting.
Oh, sorry. Yeah,
that's all right.
So I may be around on the 18th, but I may have trouble, work travel plans. So
okay, do you happen to know when you can confirm that or no?
I will be able to confirm it next Thursday.
Okay.
Could I just make a recommendation? Our town meeting is on the 9th. I mean, our town election's on the 9th. Could we meet possibly that week before town meeting? This way we would have our restructure, we could have our organizational meeting before town meeting. We could have everything going forward.
Alfonso.
I have a region meeting scheduled on the 11th, which is Wednesday.
Okay, what does your schedule look like, Mrs. Taylor, for that week? I would say either it would be the 10th or 12th. Because Mrs. Rothwell, you would both have a meeting on the 11th, so the 10th or 12th, I don't know if they, either a specific day is better than the other.
Well, I didn't know about the 11th meeting. I still work on the Wednesdays. I didn't agree to it.
The 11th of May?
It's a Wednesday.
It's a Wednesday.
Okay.
Maybe I did last year or something. I could do the 10th late or the 12th. Well, that would be fine.
Just a quick question again. Did you say there's a regional meeting on the 11th?
Correct.
So if we could meet on the 10th, we could actually, when we have our organizational meeting, we could actually have our new regional representatives as well, and they can get sworn in that morning the next day.
This is true, Mr. Machado.
So.
I am not available on the 10th.
We got to pick either the 12th.
Can we not do it on the 9th, even though it's election day?
No, we're not doing that on election day.
Okay, so here's where we go. We either got to do the 12th, 17th, or 18th.
I'll go with the 12th.
Figure it out. I mean, those are the three dates we have.
I vote the 12th.
I have the 12th.
Okay.
I'm available for 12.
The 12th, Mrs. Tara?
Yeah, this meeting weeks, that's fine.
Yep. Okay.
Wait, how does administration feel about this? Can we ask? That's a meeting and meeting and meeting and meeting that week. How do you feel about this?
How do I feel if the 12th isn't used for something? Someone's going to be booking a subcommittee meeting anyway, so I'm going to be meeting somewhere.
Okay, well, you didn't help me out, so I guess it's the 12th.
The 12th works for.
The 12th is better for me. Sorry.
Well, then we have the town, we can have our reorganizational meeting before town.
So we're gonna hold the meeting on the 12th of May at 6:30 here in the school committee.
The 19th.
To May 12th.
To the 12th.
Robin, I'm going to lean on you to just kind of give me a gentle reminder towards the end of the month, right? Okay, so May 12th, that works for everybody, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Busy week.
Let me just put that down so I don't forget.
Mr. Maggiore.
Yes.
How about April 28th, the joint meeting I have on my calendar? Is that still going on?
That's a question I was going to ask Mr. Schoonover when we got to the regional district, but we might as well discuss it now since we're talking about meeting dates. April 28th, is there a specific reason we would have a joint meeting?
It was one of those dates that we created last summer to have, you know, roughly every other month. The one, obviously, we just had one in at Berkeley that was not originally on the calendar. At this point, I know we have, after tonight, we really have a week off from school. I can't see what, unless Mrs. Albanez could see a reason that we would have a joint meeting.
We were gonna try to do food service, but I'll have to do that separately because it's different contracts.
I know you're traveling, right?
Yeah, I don't think you would like a remote meeting if that.
Well, if there's no reason to have the meeting, if either one of them is not doing a presentation, then I think we'll just worry about meeting, our committee meeting on the 12th. If that changes, obviously, we'll let you know. But at this point, I would say that there's not a need for a joint meeting. All right, so we are.
So are we taking that off our calendar, or are we waiting
for? I would take it off the calendar.
I'm sure there'll still be a region meeting.
I'm not taking.
It's up to you guys.
Don't get carried away.
That's not on our plate. That's up to you guys to figure that out. But I was next time will be the 12th.
I love that.
All right.
It's so true.
Number four under new business is our regional school committee representatives. I believe we have to wait till after the election to do that. Is that correct?
Yeah, the regional agreement specifically, there is language in there that specifically states after the election, it will then a vote will be made. So even though we have two members that are running unopposed, I think it's premature for us to do that.
Yeah, I think the reason why we placed this on the agenda is just to show that, it is as the administrator, the administration probably knows best. And so to you and Mrs. Tara and those that have served on both boards, being on the region as the delegate for the K-8 representative, it's a huge requirement for one person to be, like you just mentioned, I'm leaving this on my calendar because they meet so often. And the reason why I mentioned or asked or we spoke about it quickly was I don't know if the current members are still interested in being in the following year, because if not, we need to start opening up the doors to say, hey guys, let's look at your calendar. Now, as you know, we've been moving many meetings because of Mr. Machado always traveling. I would not be able to serve on the region because I'd probably miss a lot of their meetings, but I'm just wondering who is willing to serve on the region. Because we probably need to A, make a decision, okay, I'm gonna accept this, or two, if none of us are available, are there any other options that we have, either can we ask the general public for applications to appoint someone on our behalf or anything like that? So that's why I asked that to be on the menu, because I know, on the agenda, because I believe some of us are already saying that we're probably not going to be able to be on the board next year, so.
What's the language?
I believe you had said that that's kind of a requirement, and I think for anyone knowing that they're running for K-8 on Berkeley side, I'm sure it's the same thing as Somerset, when you're running for K-8, that is the understanding. You will be a representative for the high school. And I read in the paper, because I wasn't at the last meeting, that they're looking for a 2-year commitment. I will be speaking to the region on that because I think that's a little unreasonable. I understand the reason for it, but a 2-year commitment, I don't think it's going to work in election cycles because that could fall into someone that's not getting reelected. I think the 1-year commitment is enough. So to me, the reason I am not going forward is because I have done 2 years, and I really believe that if you're going to be on K-8, you need to have a chance to serve on the region, because that gives you a full scope and a vision of where K-8 is going. So it is a disservice to not serve or have a term on the region. I have a full scope. I've also had kids graduate. So even if I did not, this would be helpful for anyone. Like, that's part of the process of being on K-8 is also being on some time for the high school.
So Robin, can you make a note to put that on the May 12th agenda, and we will appoint 2 people from this committee to serve?
If I could just speak to the language in the regional agreement. So first of all, it does say that in the regional committee's first election following the town election, they will appoint their chair and vice chair. So that will happen on May 11th, unless, I mean, the regional agreement is clear, it's at that first meeting. I don't know if there's the option to delay that until the end of May. So I'm sorry?
They have? Until we've been approved to appoint.
Okay.
In the past, because the year that I joined the region, we met after their first meeting, and once I believe myself and maybe Ann were, or no, Jameson, once we were appointed the very following meeting, that's when we had the reorganization of the region.
Okay.
They actually, that year, they particularly waited for all the representatives, not only of Somerset, but also Berkeley, to be in attendance.
Okay. So, Robin, could we put a note for the next Somerset-Berkeley agenda as well for that? Thank you. The other piece is that there is no language about what happens if members of the K-8 committee do not wish to serve on the regional committee. The link is written with the assumption that there will always be 2 members. So if that were to ever happen, we've discussed this recently in the tri-district collaboration where we've been reviewing the regional agreement. Do we have to look at that language and update it so that there is a contingency in case members of either this committee or the Berkeley committee, just there's no one there willing to step up. So that is, it kind of ties our hands with that right now, anyway.
I think come May 12th, I don't think that's going to be an issue, so I think
we can
get 2 people on this committee to serve.
Okay.
And just for clarification, because Ms. Tara, being on the Tri-District Committee as well, the discussion about the 2-year term was really if there was an individual that wanted to volunteer for a 2-year term, they wanted to leave that option open and that it wasn't limited to just a 1 year having to do it. So there was some discussion, especially on the Berkeley side, that people would want to volunteer for that time frame, and they didn't want it to be limited to an annual
basis. Okay, so it wasn't required.
Just
as another thing, there is no such thing as a 2-year agreement, because where it says we have a reorganizational meeting every year,
right?
I would never support that, nor should the region. It should be the decision, because now you're mandating, the region is mandating both the K-8s of both that they should serve 2 years, because as a newly elected member who gets elected to the K-8 may not have the opportunity for that first year to join. I think it should be a yearly appointment as it is now, and it should, they may request that you serve 2 years, but it's not a mandatory thing, nor should it even be a per quo, oh, you really should serve 2 years. It should be the choice of that member.
Again, the discussion was, and I want to make sure that there's not a perception that it was a mandate, because I think that's a strong word to use. It was more of if somebody was like, I want to be on it, and I want to be on it for 2 years, you know. But it's valid points that you
Yeah, but even if, you know, I could want to serve for 2 years, but it doesn't mean that's the wish of the rest of the committee.
Correct.
So.
So on May 12th, we'll appoint two of us. We'll figure between us five, we can figure that out, and then we'll do that
on
that meeting.
And maybe if there's somebody that has an interest, they can reach out to you to give you a heads up as the chair.
Everybody has my phone number and email, so feel free to call. All right, and then I'm going to guess that the next item under new business for elementary specialization, we're going to hear a little presentation from Ms. Haskell, right?
You are.
You know, there we go. So I will turn this over to you.
Great. We have been talking since I arrived in July. I've talked to a lot of different key groups and have really been asking the questions about our curriculum and our instruction, and we've had a lot of those conversations with this team also. And so we've spoken with our elementary leadership teams. I have held what we call 50-50 meetings. 50% of the time, the teachers get to talk to me about anything that they want, and then the other 50% of the time, I get to ask them any question that I want. And a lot of this is centered around our curriculum and our instruction and assessment. And then we also had our CIA curriculum instruction assessment team. We have a team of operatives. CIA operatives that have been meeting. We started in February with those three full days as we looked at our literacy action plan, our STEAM action plan, and the beginnings of our technology plan, and have continued to meet with this full team, with all of our faculty and staff being invited to our CIA to be operatives and to really help with the planning piece. And we also have done some research. So this is some of our data collection, and these are also the same people who have been involved as we've started to plan our curriculum and really the investment that we're going to make this coming year. And the decision that we have made is that we are going to implement what we're calling teacher specialization. And teacher specialization, sometimes called content specialization, simply means that teachers who focus on, or we have teachers who focus on a particular subject area. So we are actually going to pair the subjects, and we're going to have our English language arts paired with social studies, and we are going to have the other teacher will focus on STEM, so our math and our science, technology, engineering, and math will be that other teacher. We have, again, in the course of this, we have proposed a plan, and we got some teacher feedback, and listened to a lot of what our teachers and our experts, really that's who they are, had to say. And the way that we have decided to roll out this plan is grades 3, 4, and 5, the teachers will specialize. Grades K-1 and 2, we have given the teachers the opportunity to talk amongst their teams, their grade level teams, and to decide whether they will specialize next year or if they will stay in that self-contained classroom. And we are investing in our, we have two pilot programs going on right now. One is an ELA pilot. We started with three programs that we were piloting. We are down to two. And we will make a decision about which ELA program we will move forward with before the end of the year. And we have three math programs that are currently being piloted. And so, again, we will make a decision about which math program we will adopt before the end of the year. And so, and again, the teachers are doing the piloting on May 9th, early release day. All of the teachers will get the information about the pilots and the experience that the teachers have had and the strengths and the areas of concern that teachers would have with each of the individual programs, and teachers will again be able to give us some of their thoughts. And we will move into next year with a new ELA program, a new math program, and a plan for teachers to be implementing these programs within their classrooms. So the rationale, we know that children learn best when they make connections in their learning. And obviously they're able to do that in one classroom with one teacher, but we have not had a lot of professional learning opportunities over the course of the last few years. And our curriculum frameworks are rigorous, and we have really high expectations of what we want kids to know and be able to do and understand and apply in real world situations. And because we have not had a lot of that learning, our teachers have not had a lot of that learning, and we have clearly identified, even in this team, that we are in need of those resources. We are going to give teachers an opportunity to really learn deeply in these areas so our kids will benefit immediately. We are confident in the K-1 and 2 realm. One of the reasons we offered some choice is because early childhood, it's a little bit different than 3rd, 4th, and 5th grade. And so, again, there's not a lot of research that indicates that specialization in the lower grades would hurt or help. There's really no research that's indicating either. So again, giving the choice gives teachers an opportunity to try something, and we're going to monitor the data and the response, and we will determine what's working and what's not working, and we can adjust accordingly. The investment that we make, the way that textbooks are working now, is we're buying them for all kids anyway. So this is not necessarily a monetary savings of any sort, because kids will still have the access. But it, in terms of teacher learning and teacher focus, we're giving them some opportunity to really learn more deeply and apply that immediately. As we redesign our curriculum units, we're going to make sure we're integrating the content standards in an authentic way. And we also are going to work to shift some of our instructional practices. And we've started that already this year with our STEM scopes, our new science program. But we really, and we've talked about our kids doing the doing and really having a hands-on learning experience and making meaning of their learning, and again, being able to apply that in real-world situations, not just in the classroom. Again, in terms of the rationale, literacy is the foundation of all learning, and teachers will be able to embed literacy of the reading, writing, speaking, listening, and digital literacy, we talked a little bit about technology, into their instruction, regardless of what subject area they teach. And so this is what our overall plan is. You do have a little handout that I gave you with some explanation about what some of this means to our teachers, what it means to me as a parent. That was one of the sections that we talked about making sure that we share, because our kids have adults that care about them. They have interactions with adults, lots of adults, every day. They're teachers in their special areas, and school support staff, whether it be psychologists, social workers, the school nurse, the secretaries. This is just one more person to really help provide support for our kids and that knows our child, and again, is going to improve not only the academic piece, but also the social emotional piece. And we're looking forward to it. I think that, and we've talked about this, we're not sure about all of the details. And we talked to teachers about that and actually had a meeting. And I started the meeting and said, we have, you know, we're gonna give you the plan. We don't have a lot of details. You're gonna have a lot of questions. We won't have answers yet, because we want to involve the teachers as we build this plan. We certainly could sit down in a room and come up with a schedule and how this is all going to work and all of the logistics, but they have to live it. And so they have been really helpful and thoughtful about some of the things that we need to consider. And we have what we call a parking lot. So all of these ideas we have put on our parking lot and we will take into consideration as we do in fact move forward with our planning and our scheduling. And even teachers have followed up with, you know, I was thinking about it after the meeting and here are some, you know, just some thoughts, and we've added them to the parking lot. So I think that it's really important for us to continue that open dialogue and, again, to identify the things that are working and continue to do those. And if we have some hiccups and, you know, we're able to talk about them and make some adjustments to ensure that kids are getting what they need. So.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Askew?
I have one question. Is there room down the road? I know we focus on STEM, but I know STEAM has kind of been something that's been talked about as well. Is that something that there would be room to add the arts in there? So it'd be under STEAM as a team?
So we've had a lot of conversation about this, and it's even with our CIA operatives have talked about this at length. And there's a lot of back and forth. So we are trying to approach this, again, in a manner that is open to all of those possibilities, and the A and the arts really fit into both that humanities side and the STEM side. And so looking at how we integrate and weave that all the way through our curriculum redesign is something that we're going to be very mindful of. And it is not only with the visual arts, but also the music piece. And when we're talking about the engineering and the math and the science, really that design thinking that that art is built on, the visual arts as they're designing their piece, or music as they are composing their piece, again, can be integrated into basically all subject areas. So whether we're calling it STEAM or we are just ensuring that the arts are in fact a part of the work that we're doing, we will be mindful of that.
Okay, just something to think of it down the road, because
absolutely,
they have the specialty, you know, I'm sure a regular teacher might not have that music specialty,
yes,
or the art specialty. So to bring that professional piece in that has that overlook to add to that. So I'm not sure if during this pilot program, if that's something they might think, this is kind of what we're missing. We might need that expertise to come in the team. And that's something that the team's open to.
And as we are currently developing our STEAM action plan, that's one of the components of it. How can we integrate the arts, build that into the curriculum, and encourage the collaboration among classroom teachers and our art teachers. And so we'll be developing a plan for that work.
Okay, so and there'll be some informal education within this plan as well, as far as doing the social component within it.
Yes, that
oh,
will
yes,
be.
Absolutely.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Thank you.
So if I can,
yeah, sure.
So
if I'm understanding this correctly, because this is a change, and I know that when my daughter went to North in fourth and fifth grade, they did have a split of teacher, you know, to go to math and everything, and it was a great opportunity to prepare them for middle school because they'll be changing students. So I understand that. Will you have a teacher that is still like your primary teacher that the parents will go to, or will the parents know that for ELA they have teacher A and for science they have teacher B? Am I understanding that correctly?
You are.
Okay.
They will know who is teaching what. There is a team-like approach, so they are shared students, and they're not forever split. There will be opportunities for some of that integration between the subjects. We have talked about our RTI periods, and there's opportunities again for that support piece built into the day, so they're not. You know, it's not necessarily RTI with just one teacher. We actually have two teachers who could be responsible for different groups, and depending on what the kids' needs are, they could be even more personalized in terms of the support that students are getting. But in terms of the subject areas, there will be a teacher who will be designated the ELA social studies teacher, and a teacher who will be designated the STEM teacher.
So the children in the ELA, it's not, would the whole class move, or would there be like a mixture of kids that, or students that would go to this particular math section, and another group would go to this particular math session, or do you not have that worked out? If you're understanding me, like, would it be like classroom, like, they would follow the class, or?
It's not like that now with math, right? Today in math, you can have classroom A, when it comes to math,
mm-hmm.
they don't all go to one math because they kind of split up.
So North, for instance, has about, well, in third, fourth, and fifth grade, we have four sections per grade level, four different classes. Let's just say at South, across the board, we have two classes. So it could take on some different roles. You know, it could look a little bit different. You know, again, as Liz said, there are some things that we haven't, you know, there's still some questions that we need to work out. At South, for instance, and for most of the classes at Chase, where we have two classes per grade level, it's really that, more of that team approach. So they'll be getting, you know, a group of kids will be getting their ELA instruction with one, while the other group is getting their STEM with, you know, teacher B, and then they will switch off. At North, whether or not that will also take on the paired aspect, which I believe that's probably, I think that's where we're leaning toward, where they'll, you know, two teachers will pair up and then they'll share their students. But because of the size of North, I think there's a little bit more flexibility with that, and if they feel like there is a better way to mix things up, and if the teachers think that students will get better services, you know, if they can expand their approach sort of the way it's done now, I would encourage those conversations.
And is there any obstacles with the selection as to ELA versus science, and, you know, for those teachers, or is that kind of a collaborative effort, or is there a contractual issue with that?
There have not been any issues thus far. A couple of questions. If circumstances were to change, so they, you know, the teachers grades K-1 and 2 have made a decision, and if for some reason some circumstances changed, you know, there was a question as to whether they could change their mind and decide not to do what they chose. And with a change of circumstance, we want to work with teachers. We want this to be successful. We want to support them as best they can, because they are the ones who are supporting our kids. So there's some flexibility there in terms of that scheduling piece. There are some classrooms we have teams of three teachers, or at some grade levels that we have teams of three teachers. And, you know, we have talked to teachers and asked them to think about, you know, what are they currently doing, is it working, and how can we structure this in a way, again, that best supports kids. And then we're going to do our best to find a way to work that into the schedule. So really the core of the decisions that we're making are based on what's in the best interest of our kids, and how can we support that. And our teacher learning. And we are, I think people are starting to get excited. They're looking forward to these new resources, and they're looking forward to their own learning and their own growth. And it's going to be amazing when our kids have access to these new resources. People are excited. And we're looking at professional development starting, you know, that was one of the main questions. Is this going to, you know, are we going to have the stuff that we need and we can look at it over the summer? We're starting our professional development in June before you leave. You will have what you need. Okay, it's kind of like Christmas in June, or, you know, Hanukkah in June. It's really exciting, and they are looking forward to it. And so there have been a lot of samples that have gone out, and we can't make a bad choice. We have our pilot team, actually, we're scheduled to meet this week, and there's a lot going on. And so we decided not to meet, and we're doing a lot of our work on Google. And people have decided to schedule a meeting together because they'd like to talk about it and talk about the work that they're doing, and That was not prompted by me. That is the initiative that they've taken, and I don't think that we're going to have any bad choices, which is exciting.
Yeah, and our teachers, just across the board, just are working so hard, extremely hard. And for elementary teachers, I was a high school teacher, I can't imagine being an elementary teacher. They do everything from, you know, they're teaching reading, writing, and then with reading, there are so many components of that. They're teaching science and social studies and social skills, and it's incredible how much elementary teachers teach to that one group of students. And this is just focusing their energy and attention to a smaller, you know, they're having twice as many students, but they're being able to focus their instruction in a core area. And as Liz said, they'll be able to make those connections a little bit more between science and math and social studies, and you know, what they're reading in that nonfiction text and applying their writing and reading skills to that. So we're really excited about what this is going to look like. But I would also say, I think someone referenced the association. We have, Christine and I have met about this. She was present at that meeting a few weeks ago with the elementary teachers. So, you know, we're making sure that we are inclusive right away with teachers, with the STA, so that we are all working together in this process.
Yes, Mr. Michelle.
I kind of like where you're going. I like that every teacher has strengths. You know, some may be great ELA, some may be great STEM teachers, and, you know, how are we going to address kids' property? Like right now, currently, they go into school, they have a classroom, they put their lunch bags in a closet and all of that. We don't have lockers. How are we doing, how does that work? Like, are they still going to be able to, are they going to be carrying backpacks all day? How does that work? Like the students itself from going from class to class. Well, that's what I'm wondering. Are the teachers moving to, I don't think the teachers are going to be moving from class to class, or are the students going to be moving from location A to go to location B, but where are they putting all their property?
Students will move because, you know, let's just say for a science lesson, you don't want to cart the materials back and forth. It needs a home. So just as now at North, our students are moving back to back, you know, from one class to another, and maybe that's one of those questions we ask our North teachers who have been doing this for a long time. How does this really work? And at South, our two fourth grade teachers have been doing this on their own for a little while, and with writing and I believe with math. So we'll take some of these little pockets around the district where these teachers have voluntarily done this already, and we'll ask them those questions. How does, you know, what, you know, struggles have you had? What works really well? And teachers know better. We'll bring them in and we'll answer those questions, but that's
it's on the parking lot. I've added it. So
right,
thank you.
Just out of curiosity.
Yep, it's on our list.
All right, so I have more questions, and I think kind of for clarification, like, so my kids go to North now, and when they got here, it was a change because, you know, you have your regular classroom teacher and they go out for math. Do they go out for, obviously they go out for gym and art and music,
right,
and that kind of stuff, but is it just that they leave the classroom for math now, or how does that work at North today?
In fourth grade at North, they switch their math classes.
Just for math, right?
Yes.
Okay.
In fifth grade, they move around for just about everything. We have two of the four teachers teach science, two of the teachers teach social studies. Each of the teachers has a different math role. So in fifth grade here, I believe students can have up to three of those fifth grade teachers right now. They'll have their regular homeroom teacher. They might have Mrs. French for math, and they could have Mrs. Mello for science, and Mrs. Ahern is their homeroom teacher. So, you know, that's the way it works. Fifth grade is already close to this model.
Okay.
Here.
And that's only at North. So you're saying South and Chase, for the most part, except for the fourth grade classes that you mentioned, one teacher the whole day, all subjects?
Yes.
Okay, so what you're talking about here is doing a specialization across all three elementary schools.
In grades three, four, and five.
So that's grades three, four, and five.
Right.
Okay.
Good practice.
So to make sure.
But would there just be the teachers? I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Jumping in.
Chase teachers, South teachers, I mean, or will they move from campus to campus?
No.
Okay, thank you.
So obviously one of the concerns I do have is, okay, you've got four fourth grade teachers, three of them want to do math.
We've not had that problem.
Yet.
I don't think that we're going to. We have asked for their input already.
Okay.
And we've not had this at all.
And they are meeting on the side and they're having these conversations with each other and they're saying, I'd really like to teach this, what do you think? And then they're telling us, this is what I'd like to do. And then shortly after that, we get an email from the other teacher saying, this is what I'd like to do. And so you can tell that they've had these conversations and then informing us. So as Liz said, it hasn't happened yet. Could it happen possibly, but not yet.
So what kind of policies, procedures, because you have to come up with something, because at some point someone is going to say, I don't like to teach science, but that's where I'm being positioned. What are my options at that point? Does that, and again, that's probably more of a,
that's,
you know,
for us to work out with the STA.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right.
That's kind of a,
I would just like to see that.
That's where the contractual question came in.
Yeah.
I would assume currently you may have these issues, but once the program is running and if it's successful, once a teacher retires or leaves the districts, then you're basically posting it as a math elementary position. Could possibly be something like you would do with the middle school when you're hiring a new middle school teacher. I think you're hiring based on the subject. So it may just become a future, if it's successful, I'm sure they're just going to hire, people are going to know that they're applying for a certain position where they're not saying, well, I really want to teach science. Right now you may have these problems, but I think all the teachers are getting together and working collaborative, so I don't see it being a problem later on.
But think about that. If there's a position open in third grade,
yep,
a second grade teacher's in it, I want to go there. Right,
well,
now what if that
people get out of positions currently?
Yeah, I understand that. So that happens now where teachers can move freely as long as they have a certification.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and there's no certification for specializations, I would imagine.
Nope, it's all the same, it's elementary.
Okay, and what if, and I know you guys probably don't have all the answers, so I understand that. What if this year I say, hey, you know what, I want to be a science teacher, and next year I say, you know what, I'm good. Do you reshuffle the deck every year? Or like Mr. Machado says, if you sign up to be, you know, the humanities ELA, is that where you are until a position on the math side opens?
So I think that there are going to be opportunities there. Even now in the contract, there are opportunities for transfers, and there are deadlines that are written into some of that. Some of it is dependent on whether there are openings or not, and it's not uncommon at any level, but even at the elementary level, for them to maybe want to change grade levels or try something different or try something new. One of the things we did talk about is kind of the sustainability of the professional development piece. As we get new teachers in, as we have our teachers who may want to do a shift or do a switch, those are things that I'm not sure that it's much different with specialization than it would be with a grade level at the elementary. And I think that it would continue kind of the way that it has, and we want to provide some support for our teachers. As they have an elementary certification, we want to make sure that they are able to delve deeper into the learning of the area that they have chosen, but that doesn't mean that they're excluded from what we do with the other professional development and the things that we're offering. And, you know, we want teachers to be well-rounded. We want them to have the skills that they need. As far as our ensuring that our kids have what they need as we are transitioning to MCAS 2.0 after PARC this year, with, you know, what we still affectionately refer to as the new frameworks that came out in 2011, this is the way that is going to meet the needs of our kids now. And that is that was the major motivation behind this decision. And moving forward, if we are finding success, then I would anticipate we would continue. If we're not, we're going to need to reassess and make an adjustment. But I think that there, we don't have the answers for all the what-ifs, and again, we would like to work collaboratively. We want this to be successful, we want teachers to be successful, and most of all, we want our kids to get what they need. And I feel like this whole process has really been inclusive of all of our key stakeholders, and we have really tried to be good listeners, and we're not going to, it's not going to be perfect. But we would like it to be functional, and we would like it to, again, meet the needs of our kids.
All right, so one more question.
Okay.
Who else is doing this?
Who else is doing?
What other districts are following this model?
There are actually quite a few with the specialization at the grades 3, 4, and 5. Swansea, Fall River.
Norton as low, was it Norton or Easton?
Easton
as low as lower grades than what we're doing.
They gave a choice with right. Easton, much like we did.
Mm-hmm.
So
we can use those schools as models as right. far as policy for teacher moves mm-hmm. and selections and all that kind of
right.
stuff.
Yeah, Dartmouth, I think, also at the fifth grade level does specialize. Mm-hmm.
And I think I know the answer, but I just want to be clear. Is it third grade teachers, fourth grade teachers, fifth grade teachers that they will be specialized for that curriculum for the 4th, 5th, and 6th? Or is it possible that you could have one teacher teaching science, third grade one section, and then fourth grade the next, and then fifth grade? No, they wouldn't have three different curriculums. Then.
Not to roll this out, no.
Okay.
We are looking for them to be at one grade level with, for most teachers, it will be with two classrooms of children. We, again, depending on how some of this goes, or, you know, if teachers were looking to shift or move, you know, we would ensure that they got some of that professional learning. Our first year, much of the work we'll be doing will be centered on the rollout of these new programs and all the resources, really, that we have. There's a technology piece, using the trade books and the stories and the writing process, you know, kind of being able to integrate all of those pieces, bring in our STEM scopes that we have had an opportunity to really get to know this year, to be able to align that work as we really design our new curriculum, and providing some of that support for the teachers as we go along. So they, like our kids, are professional learners, and we'll help support those various pieces as we go along, and then we're also looking forward to our professional development plan for the next 2 and 3 years, again, to ensure that our teachers are getting everything that they need to best support our kids. So,
so as you said, children are resilient. So, and I see it as an advantage instead of having one teacher that, you know, fresh face, and I know that just from my own as a parent, my daughter did very well with that change, you know, the schedule, and when she moved to Chase and nothing against the teacher, but that one face in front of her all day. It became kind of, you know, difficult for her to continue on her focus. But I don't want to lose my train of thought here as I went on a tangent. And I did.
About teachers specializing only in third grade or fourth grade.
No, that wasn't it.
Something new?
I went off on a tangent.
Senior moment.
How embarrassing.
You know,
very senior moment or blonde moment.
I have a question.
Know.
If you want, I can ask and we can
start. Okay, go ahead and I'll come back to it. Go.
So, as far as assessing the, like I know you said you were piloting different curriculum packages.
Yes.
How did that work? Like, you have three different math curriculum that you want to assess. How many teachers got their hands on that?
It depends
on
the program. I think total, with both the ELA and the math programs, we had 30 teachers who were somehow involved in piloting one of these programs.
And we have 50 elementary classrooms, K-5.
So you have 50 K-5, or should I do the math here?
50 K-5 classes, right? You had 30 different assessments.
Well, 30 different teachers?
30 different teachers.
So 60% of our teachers were involved in this pilot.
And support.
And some were doing math, and some were doing ELA.
Some are, and we have.
Science and.
Yes, no, not science. Math and ELA.
Yeah.
And we have some special education teachers, some interventionists, who have also been involved in this piloting process.
So without me trying to figure out the math, one of the things that, I always look at work and all that other stuff is, is your sample healthy enough? Right, and obviously, you guys do this for a living, right? So if you put, an example is, you have three different ELA programs, and you have one teacher assessing.
We have one teacher, at least one teacher at every school.
Yeah.
So every school of, every pilot, every school at the elementary level.
Okay, so third grade curriculum is looking at this particular ELA package, and the third grade teacher is saying, hey, I'm working with this curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what I like, here's what I don't like.
So we have a rubric that is guiding our assessment of the program, and everybody's using the same rubric, and there is a column on the rubric for evidence. So teachers get their, have this firsthand experience and firsthand knowledge of the program that they are using and implementing. They've all gotten training in each of the, whatever program they're piloting. Everybody has gotten at least one day of training or a half day of training, and then an opportunity to do some planning with their grade level. And they are either collaboratively or individually assessing their program and making their own judgments in each of the categories with evidence to support whatever their judgment is. There is a quantitative piece where they will, there's a score range that falls into exceptional, good, and poor. And so they are submitting all of that via Google Drive. So our leadership team has access to that, and all of the pilot teachers have access to that data. So this is a data gathering mission for us. We are very interested in what the teachers have to say, having experienced it, because having a salesperson come is fine, but nobody actually gets to really learn that hands-on piece and what the strengths and maybe some of the weaknesses are. So they've really had this opportunity. In addition, they are in constant discussion. So even when you get them into the room, we actually met in here, it was really funny because it's a little bit like a competition. You know, mine has trade books and we have 5 for every unit. They're like, oh yeah, well I have 12. And they're like, oh, you have 12? So this is part of how we're, you know, they're starting to have these conversations, and the leadership team is able to look at this data, and our principals have identified on this rubric what the most important pieces are in terms of teaching and learning. So as we move forward to make a decision, we have this data to inform our decision so that we're making a choice that is best going to support the needs of our kids and the learning needs of our kids.
Okay.
I do.
One more thing, so maybe you should write that down.
I wrote it down.
All right, so first of all, I love data, right? So when you guys say you have a rubric, right? And it sounds like the rubric is pretty well thought out. Is that our rubric, or is that a standardized rubric for assessing curriculum?
It is not standardized.
Is there a standardized method rubric to assess curriculum?
No.
Why not?
Because nobody's created it yet.
That's something you guys.
Excel spreadsheet, Mike. There you go.
But so it's a product, right?
There you go.
You know, I'm going to take some notes because this is my over the summer. This one.
But I the one what we are using really is So we are using it at the elementary level. We're also using it at the middle school to assess the science pilot that they have run. So it is universal enough, it is broad enough to meet the needs of multiple content areas. It is, but yet focused enough to align with our priorities and the work that we're doing, you know, it's full of edubabble, you know, those educational, yes, those educational, you know, catchphrases and, but there are educational priorities. And so I will say, I did get some feedback today. I met with Nicole Mello, who is the science content coordinator at the middle school, and she had found another rubric. It was 11 pages long. So she said, this one might be a little long for what we're looking at. And I said, it does seem long, but is there anything on there that you would have liked to have seen on this that you think would help us make a better decision? So she was gonna look through that and make some recommendations. So I think that it's something we can certainly look at, but I have to say, we have 30 teachers who are involved in this, and there has not been any confusion. It's super clear. And again, that evidence piece is really the important part. Everybody's entitled to their judgment, but we're looking for them to be able to substantiate it and support it with the evidence based on their actual experience.
And please don't take my questions as being like judgmental or any of that, because first of all, I think you guys are definitely going the right path for my personal knowledge, and anybody that's out there, hopefully, I think some people have the same questions I do. So I think you guys are absolutely going down the right path. Just, I needed to understand that process, so.
And that's why we're here. Thank you for asking the question.
Mrs. Rothwell, did you remember your question?
I do. All
right.
Thank you for coming back to me.
You're welcome.
Now, Mr. Patel is all about process and procedure and how that all works.
And data.
And Dan.
He loves data.
Yes.
Metrics.
So,
metrics.
So you can almost assume where I'm gonna go, because now more on the human factor.
Yes.
Of things. So what you have explained to us is that we have a pilot program for the ELA, and we have three math programs being piloted, correct?
We have two for ELA.
Two for ELA and two for math.
Three for math.
Okay. And we are now talking, we've got our CIAs, and we're getting together, and now we're talking that we're going to specialize, we're going to change the schedule. We're going to have teachers responsible for more students for a specific subject, which is a huge change for this district. And next year we'll be rolling out that curriculum change to all of our teachers. It's a lot of change. So on the humanistic side, now I know you said our teachers are professional, and I do agree with you that they're professional, but that amount of change can cause disruption in itself. Have we strategized as to how we deliver that message and how we manage change for our teachers?
Yes. Part of our choice to specialize actually is meant to make it manageable. So there are districts who bring in multiple new curricula all at once. Or it is year after year after year, and never provide the opportunity for this new professional learning to, the input comes in and teachers are learning and they're understanding and they don't have enough time to make meaning of all of that change, and then the next one comes in. And so as we were talking about it, that is something that would absolutely raise anxiety and be stressful. It's a huge amount of change. So we have tried to chunk it and make it a manageable amount with that focus on specifically the ELA side and the math side, because there is some experience with the science, having had some time this year to work with STEM scopes. So although it is back to back, there, as we're designing the curriculum, it now becomes a strategic and conscious design that integrates the two, and looking at the arts and the other pieces, and then an alignment with what's happening in ELA and social studies, because we can do some science content reading during our ELA time. And so again, there is a lot of change and updating that we know needs to happen because we haven't had the resources. This seems to be a plan that will help to meet the teachers' needs along with the professional development. Our professional development plan, we went over the calendar earlier. There are more days in next year's calendar than this year. And it will help better support the professional learning needs of the teachers. We are working our content coordinators, our principals, and our CIA are talking about professional development and what the teacher's professional needs are. And that was even some of the time Mr. Schoonover talked about. Sometimes the plan will be grade level teams. They have to have the time to talk to each other, to look at the work that they've already done, maybe to look at some student work, so that we can really move forward in a pace that is manageable. And the conversations we're having are specific to PD for professional development for next year, but most of our conversations actually include professional development for 16-17 and 17-18 and 18-19. And so, you know, I actually on the wall in my office have things laid out, and there are multiple big post-its that have the little post-its that are movable to them depending on the year. So we're constantly making those adjustments, and again, we need to be good listeners, and so that we can hear what the teachers are saying, and so that there's an opportunity for them to have a voice as we make this change. But we are confident that, again, working together as a team and having clarity of vision in terms of where we're headed is going to give us what we need to move our kids to the next level of their learning.
If I can just, I'll end this with, we discussed that and what the timeline should be. When Liz presented the MCAS scores a few months ago, we talked about some urgency and we need to do things differently. Teachers need, and students need better resources in their hands. Teachers need more professional development. And this specialization was also just a way that we thought would drive student achievement. We talked about, you know, do we change, put this over 2 years or 3 years, or, you know, do we just focus on math this year and ELA next? But in our conversations and at the leadership meetings with the directors and principals, it always came down to, what about the kids in the classes now? We can't wait a few years before we do something for the kids who are already in our classes. So we are doing a lot. We're also doing structuring this in a way where, you know, we're trying to take something off the plate too. But you know, we need to make sure that we are providing we're doing everything we can for the kids who are currently in our classes. And I'll end with a quote that I shared with teachers on the first day of school. And I'll probably butcher it, but it's a Vince Lombardi quote, something to the effect of, perfection is not attainable, but if we chase perfection, we'll catch excellence. And that's our theme all year long, is that charting that course to excellence. This is part of it. And we all truly believe that we need to tweak a few things, provide a little bit more support for students and teachers, and I'm telling you, a few years from now, we will be a level one district. And that's our goal.
Well, I do think it's great, although I was asking a lot of questions. I think it's continuity for all of our students in each grade as to what they're being taught. And I envision you probably will be having common planning time with all the campuses, which goes back to your statement that we have one elementary school with three campuses, and there could be common planning time on Skype or whatever to make sure that all three schools are coming together and teaching the same thing. So, good for you.
Thank you.
It's a lot.
Next on the agenda, under unfinished business, we have listed a report of the policy subcommittee. I don't know if there's any updates or anything that needs to be brought to our attention.
There's nothing to present to the committee at this time, but I will let you know that we have met At our last meeting, we did meet with some representative of Fisher Bus to talk about transportation. We wanted to discuss our current policy, and we wanted to reflect with them as to what are the actual practices out on the field, and do they match, or are there some things that we need to work on? So there isn't anything finalized at this point, but we had a pretty lengthy meeting with them a couple of weeks ago.
Great, thank you.
Can I add something?
Sure.
So, I'm not sure if everyone received the letter, but there is from MASC that we need to look at a policy for substance abuse and Narcan. So that's something that was put on the website. It's something that maybe Ms. Rothwell might want to look at. I'm not sure if you got the notification. Ms. Rothwell?
No, I don't recall.
And I know it's geared more towards the high school, however, it might be something that we need to look at for all grades, even though most likely won't happen in younger grades. We do have a middle school going into the high school, so I know the governor put in a new program and new requirements, but some things might also pertain to our middle school.
So they actually brought something up at the PTO meeting this week. One of the parents was there, and she's a counselor that works with adolescents, and she presented us with I can't remember exactly what it was called, something about Purple.
Project Purple.
Project Purple. Mm-hmm. And she mentioned Chris Heron, and although we all discussed it, we weren't sure if he would be appropriate to come and speak to that age level. There was discussion about whether or not to see if he could come in and speak to the parents of the students, maybe as a community, and then determine whether it was appropriate to come and have anything at the middle school. So there was a lot of conversation about it at the PTO meeting, so.
Yeah, this is a substance abuse prevention and education, so that would probably go under the purview, and then it would be, it's the new chapter 71, section 96, that we have to post policies related to the subject matter. So it's something that we need to get talking for an upcoming year. That's great to bring that forward as an idea.
Right, and we are, I will update the committee, and I believe you'll probably get information from AMASC as well. We're waiting for direction from the state as to about those screenings, the drug screenings that we have to have, what grade levels or what grade spans they have to occur in. My guess is one of them will be in the middle school level in addition to the high school. I think it's we have to have it in two different grades. But we're waiting. There have been very few details about that. They'll design the screening, they'll give it to us, and then I'm sure MASC will develop some model policies.
Another idea I'd just like to throw out, since you had mentioned about Project Purple. I did reach out to a organization, and it's from Castle, which is from High Point, and they have a traveling kind of high school adolescent team that goes and just kind of plays, like reenactment to middle school and high school level. So they're actually kids that are in recovery. So I was looking at some prices to bring forward to the committee to see if that was some interest, maybe something at the high school to split and, you know, the middle school. But it seemed like something that'd be very interactive and kids relate to other kids and stories. So
would you share that?
I will share it.
Thank you.
I'm just getting them information. So.
Okay, thank you.
Well, thank you. Some informational items. I don't know if there's anything on the regional district report from either Mrs. Tara or Mrs. Rothwell.
I was not able to attend the last district meeting, and I don't think Ms. Tara was
able to. I was ill and just getting a little better now.
So we will hopefully get an update on May 12th should there be anything that needs to be brought to our attention. And then next under informational items, we had Kids Summer Learning Center. I think Mr. Aguiar was here last year talking about some of the programs that they're running at the high school. And there's a pamphlet here that talks about quite a few different programs that they're going to be running at the high school this summer for kids. It looks like pretty much grades three and up. And just kind of really looking through this quickly, there's some pretty amazing programs for the summer to keep the kids engaged and hopefully keep them a little sharp with their skills for math and other types of things. So if parents are interested, Mr. Schoonover, where can they get information here, they have to contact the SAG yard?
That brochure is on the website, and I believe, did we also send that out to all families through one call? We haven't yet.
Yeah, yes, okay.
I thought you said, maybe you sent an email just to us.
So.
But I remember seeing it in an email.
Okay.
On the Somerset PS website too, or is it just on the?
I believe it's on both websites.
It's on the, all right, so you can either look on the website, a phone number to call, for more information would be 508-324-3146, or 508-324-3115, extension 1090 or 1091. Or you can email Mr. Aguiar directly. I think he, you know, he can answer any questions at aguiarw@sbregional.org. And obviously, if there's ever any questions, or a parent or a grandparent or any residents interested, they can always contact the central office, and we'd be more than happy to make sure they got the information. But looking at this, it looks like quite a few pretty exciting classes. So I think they'll keep the kids busy for the summer.
Jeff, do you know how many classes they had last year versus this year?
Yes, it's going up by about, I think, a factor of 3 or so.
Okay.
There were a little over maybe 130 students last year, and Mr. Aguiar's goal is about 300 for this year.
Good. Excellent. Next, either other matters or public input. Any public input? Mr. Mullins?
I got a question. I was hoping to ask the principal of the Chase School. I'll direct it to Dr. Schoonover. I was impressed by the way the kids get on the bus. It's a mad dash for seats, and I thought immediately, do you ever practice an emergency normal evacuation for the kids to get off the bus in case of an emergency?
We are required to every
okay.
year.
Okay.
Yes.
The other question I noticed on the scene of a bus going away, they have an emergency door on the bus. And do all your buses have that? It seemed to me I see a couple of commercial buses that don't have that back door.
School buses, all school buses have that back door.
They do. Mm-hmm. And are they tested regularly?
Yes.
And do you ever have the children evacuate through those doors so they won't be terrified or it happens in an emergency?
I believe when they do their evacuation drills, they also practice going out that back door.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thanks, Mr. Mullins.
Fisher Bus makes sure that when we work with them, that they are going, that kids know how to be safe. They know how to get out of the buses quickly and promptly.
Mr. Casigas?
I'd just like to say we attended the meeting last night in the state of Somerset, and it was interesting because you guys did a nice job on the budget, and there was a couple of questions that were asked, probably going down the wrong side of the budget, where Mr. Pierce stood up and straightened it right out, which was very good. Very good to see, plus Mr. Schooner. Nice job.
Any other matters from the committee?
Yes.
Mrs. Thera?
Could I ask Ms. Haskell if she's going to have the summer program update that we had talked about at the joint meeting? Will you have that in the May meeting or the June meeting?
June.
So the ESY or
the
summer
ESY.
School?
The ESY. That was about, you want to look at some of the ideas for the extended summer program that we talked about.
That we would work with Lisa on
right.
how we might coordinate.
So an update in June?
Yes.
For the summer?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. And then if I could just bring up something, I'll bring it up here for something for review with Mr. Schoonover and Ms. Albernaz. But it's kind of brought to my attention talking about, I'm glad you brought up about the bus emergency procedure. Is there a mechanism in place that you can look at with Fisher for the special needs vans? Because there has been some concern that, you know, if a driver, something was to happen to a driver, how will the other kids be able to communicate if there was an emergency? Like, is there OnStar or is there an emergency device? Because some kids travel far, someone could have a heart attack, God forbid, or something else, and these are kids that can't self-preserve. They might just get off in a highway in the middle of the street. So I was just looking at some mechanism that might be in place as a safety to be proactive, because you never know what could happen. There has been accidents, and you don't know.
Is there anything you know about besides like OnStar?
I'm just thinking of any idea, if it may be an emergency button that kids could be trained, but you know, there can be things that can happen, and then where would those kids go? They would get off in the highway, or, and they don't have a phone, or they don't know how to use a phone.
Hopefully there's passerbys, you know, obviously you're, you know.
But, you know, no one would know until something happened, so I'm just thinking if we could, maybe there's something in place, maybe there's grants for this, I don't know.
If you could look into that, that'd be great.
Thank you, I appreciate that.
I'm sorry?
If you could look into that.
Yeah, we will.
Thank you. Anything else, other matters? Okay, something real quick that I have, and I'm gonna follow up on Mr. Cassie, because I know Mr. Schoonover made a presentation yesterday, and I know there's been a lot of chatter in town and on social media about the school budgets, and we're spending too much money, and we need to learn how to cut back, but I'm glad that George is here from the Spectator and Mike from the Herald News, because I sat down and talked with Lindsay for a little while and had her send an email out to the committee. And just looking at our operating budget and the net budget that was taxable to the residents of town, and I think there's some numbers here that are factual, so we're not hearing a lot of rhetoric on, you know, in other areas. But in fiscal year 2012, the net budget where residents got taxed was $13,737,320. This fiscal year, because of this committee working with the region, our committee getting shared administration, cutting down costs, our actual net budget that we're gonna go to town in this meeting is gonna be $12,364,170, which in five fiscal years is actually a reduction of $1.4 million. So a lot of the talk about the increase in taxes because the school is overspending and we need to learn how to cut. In the last 5 years, the tax obligation to the residents of Somerset has gone down by $1.4 million. So if there's an increase on your tax bill, you know, it's not just the schools, it's not just the municipal side, there's a lot of different variables that are playing into that. So I just want those numbers hopefully be in the paper, so the residents that are reading this understand that we have cut the budget dramatically, we've brought in shared administration, we've worked as close as we can to streamline as many operations as we can. We're looking at the transportation policy to see if we can save some more money there, and we're always looking at ways to save money. But if increases happen, and obviously we've lost a major taxpayer in town at the power plant, however, the budget on this end has come down substantially. So I just wanted to put that out there, and hopefully it gets in the paper. And, you know, obviously if there are any questions from residents, they can contact administration, any one of us, five on the school committee, and we'd be more than happy to answer any type of questions. They can come to meetings, ask us directly, instead of trying to hear secondhand from other people. So that's all I just want to put out there, and I believe everybody on the committee has that spreadsheet from Lindsay.
If I can just kind of add to that, one of the things, of course, we hear it too, as far as, you know, hey, school budgets, this going up, all that stuff. The business of education is getting increasingly more complicated, right? When everybody in this room was in school, we didn't have MCAS or PARC or any of that. We didn't have all the standards that we did. We don't have technology. We don't have, you know, all the things that comes with technology, right, infrastructure. So the fact that we're costing the town less is remarkable, given the fact of everything that we have in front of us, healthcare costs going up, right? Pretty much wherever you look, utility costs going up. Granted, you know, we're trying to offset a lot of those expenses by doing stuff like the solar project or improvements wherever we can. So it's, again, a lot of people that are taxpayers are older and remember what school was like 30, 40 years ago. It is not the same business as it was then. Things are dramatically more expensive. We need more teachers, and not only teachers, but specialists like interventionalists, and social emotional issues are a lot more prevalent today than they were, you know, even, you know, when I was a student, which I guess is getting kind of older now. But I think people need to understand that, you know, like Mr. Maggiore said, we're actually, because of state aid and a few other things, the cost to the town is less. We have increasing expenses everywhere and unfunded mandates that we're being faced with. So I just hope people understand that, and I know a lot of people that don't have school-aged children really have no idea about that. So if you guys have questions, you know, obviously some people show up, but if other people have questions, they can come to these meetings, they can call us, they can email us, whatever. You know, I think anyone on this board and this administration is, you know, perfectly willing and able to talk to anybody at any time regarding any of the questions that people out there may have. So that's me.
Thank you. All right, since we do have reason to go into executive session, so I will entertain a motion to go into executive session pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 38, Section 21A2, to conduct contract negotiations with non-union personnel, the Director of Special Education, Lisa Martesian. We have a motion, is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mrs. Rothwell, by roll call vote. Mrs. Tara?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
Mr. Botello?
Aye.
Mrs. Rothwell?
Aye.
The chair votes aye as well. We will not resume an open session. Thank you.